Oh, it's a pleasure to be with all of you, even if it would be nicer to meet in Buer and have some talk under the trees and around some real blackboard and not only virtual ones. But nevertheless, I want to share with you some impression I have to about our relation with Dirk. So the ones, yeah, it's working. Yeah, the one who knows me says that I'm proscranitator extraordinaire. And I don't really achieve anything without a deadline. As the image show. And in some sense, I hope that having two deadlines, the first one for the first date and this one would allow to me to have some polished and refined talk to present you. But in true fashion, I just finished the presentation you see a few minutes ago. I think that this comic page image have it all. I've quite worked out the problem just yet. I'm hoping, if I think around the problem, I'll have epiphany eventually. And it shows that it has worked for me in some sense to just wait a little more and things suddenly become clearer. And I'm just find it nicer to a nice way to present the things I've thought about for a long time. For this talk, I could have spoken about our recent work with Enrico Rosso, but at the time where the conference should have taken place, we were just not ready. I could have switched subject to talk about this recent development, but somehow I found it nicer to stick to the initial project. Yes, one other thing I could have shown is speak about resurgence and all those things that I learned studying the work of Ekal, and I was seeing that they can bring tremendous opportunity in field theory to resolve some long-standing problems. But nevertheless, I will try to have some parallel things. In fact, what impressed me in what Dirk has done is that he's been quite all over the world since with stay in Tasmania, which is maybe one of the farthest part of the world where you still can do physics. And myself, I began physics in what could be and really thought of another world. When I was thinking about a third subject. It was 1983. It was quite an other world. In France at this stage, quite big labs, would only take one student a year because they would like to be able to provide for a career opportunity for the guy. And so many people would start physics in a lab and then purge from the place for their entire life. And so in this year, 1983, I was just 21. I went in the office of André Deveu, which was some sort of informal advisor in École Normale Supérieure. And I said to him that I wanted to do something about non-perturbative problems in quantum field theory. And we had not quite big things to say for me. And he said, oh, it's a bit early. And then at the end of the year, it was too late, and I was just admitted as an additional student in École Normale in the theoretical physics lab of École Normale, and it just began some wandering thema around different thematics. I would not bother you with the list. It's quite long. On the way, I've done a number of things. I've been quite happy with, but in some sense, it was just when I found this article of Bellon and Kreimer, the possibility to go to up to 30 loops in some simple quantum field theory problem, that I went back to this old ambition I had. Now maybe there is some tool to go beyond the limited things which people have been able to do up to now in quantum field theory. I must say that before I was quite intrigued by the relation with knots that which is developed in this book. In fact, I must confess that I had the book on my desk in the lab for a few months, and it was just at the moment where the conference was announced to be delayed that I finally decided to open it. And now David will allow me not to speak about what I think about this relation with notes, because he says it quite clearly in a way that I would not dare to use, but in some sense, it was the first time I heard about Dirk. In the next installment, I was quite disappointed. Why do we need this hope ultimate structure if in fact you can reach the exact same conclusion without using anything more than some differential equations? In fact, it's something I would meet again later. In fact, the real meeting with Dirk was when Alan Korn exposed the common works in his course in Collège de France. I followed the course for some years now, then, and I would be a true participant up to the end. And it's sure that I miss this yearly encounters in room 5 of Collège de France with a bunch of people that would become familiar along the years. And then it was quite a revelation. I had been quite frustrated during my graduate studies in Paris that much would be said about renormalization, but nothing very clear about practicalities. And in fact, nothing really beyond what is one law prenormalization and all these quite important things that a good theory should be renormalizable, and it means renormalizable up to any order in perturbation theory. Nothing was said about how it could be done. And so with Alan Korn, we learned about how to do Bugle-Lugov recursions and use Hopf algebra of graph to solve the difficult combinatorial problems which are there. And at one of these talks, there was some person present which would talk with Anna, and I learned that it was there. I would not speak with him immediately, but at this point, he stopped to be some name, but a real person with some physical characteristics. And so at this point, I was just decided to work on this stream, but it would have to wait some more years. I proposed a colleague in our lab to plunge in the subject, but he was not so hot, and so we just went to do some numerical work on quantum integrable systems. And So the starting point would have to wait for two things. I don't really know in which order. Maybe I say the personal one before. Through a conversation with Fidel Sapotnik, encourage my wife, I decided to pack and go to Argentina. And it had to be for 1 year. Finally, it was 2 years, and it was a good thing because in the first year we could not achieve much, a little, because Fidel has had a serious health problem, what could have been a benign surgical intervention turned out to give him some nosocomial infection, which he had some struggle to clear. And so with my Argentinian collaborator, we discussed and said what can be done with this hop algebra. And the idea emerged, why not try supersymmetry? I'm still not sure if there is a good notion of a graded version of the hop algebra of graphs. A long time hunch that it could be useful if you want to work with barrel symmetries, since in this case you would need some odd graphs to to describe the nonlinear parts in the Beres transformation to make them into a full-fledged sort of Taylor identities. For me, it's still a work to be done. Pierre Clavier has done something about my first student, has done something about Bilkovsky formalism, and I hope that maybe something along this line could be made, but it did not pan out. Finally we had just the idea to look at the simplest supersymmetric in field theory, the Vesumanum model in four dimensions. And first we just studied the linear Dirichlet-Schwinger equation in the vein of Brodersen-Kreimer, and which we were quite disappointed that the equation when obtained was simply the one apart from some rescaling that Brodat and Kreimer had obtained in the Yukawa case. However, when trying to apply these things to the to a nonlinear Dyson-Schwinger equation, something quite interesting would happen. First, with respect to the things which were proposed but not really solved in Dirk and Karen article, we would have only one propagator correction to consider, because scalar, fermion, and even the auxiliary field would have the exact same correction to the to the renormalization. And furthermore, the well-known non-renormalization property of this model mean that it's not a further approximation to forget about vertex correction. They are just zero. And so we embarked, and I did not present the paper which resulted in 2008, and we were quite happy to be able to present a result to up to 200 logs and 200, at this stage a few more logs were not so difficult to obtain. Then the question, surely I was, but what to do with all these numbers? It's one thing to have a long list of coefficients for a perturbative series. It's another one to be able to deduce from this a truly non-perturbative information. For this, I would have to wait for some additional information, and I will not dwell in it now, because it's not really the thing for which works of Dirk have Dirk relevance. What has been truly relevant for our most recent works is this quite fine paper by Francis Brown and Dirk Kreimer. I would not say that it's an easy read. I must confess that as a referee to the paper, I tried to obtain some clarifications. But nevertheless, sometimes later, when I needed the ideas, I found that there were some pretty nice ideas there. What is the point? The point, or maybe we'll try to to yes, if some more time, I will show you something on the blackboard. I will not do what I've done in a president conference, where I let my chair block the view on the blackboard from the main computer. So I will stop the screen sharing so that you can hopefully have a nicer view of the blackboard. I'm just following you since I said that I will not speak about my recent work with Enrico, but it's all about this work with Enrico. What do we do with Enrico? We try to go beyond this best domino model in which I felt quite stuck for many years, because Schwinger-Dyson equation for general field theory models are not so nice. Because you may all remember that when you look about to the correction to a propagator, you have this quite dissymmetric situation where you have one bare vertex and one full vertex. But you must subtract infinities for the bare vertex. So you cannot use this to do how do you say a deficient solution, which would require to avoid all regularizations. So we used an old idea of word from which I learned through semantics, but it's more than 60 years old. You just take a derivative and then everything is fine. But there is still a problem. You try to a diagram of this kind, but how do you compute this thing? A general vertex has a complicated dependence on this entry. And you cannot just it's difficult to evaluate such a diagram if you presume that the vertex depends on all the invariants. But it's there that the idea of Marc and Kreimer, it's maybe older than what they done, but it's through them that I learned about it and whether I find that there are shortcomings in the exposition, but it's nevertheless quite clear. You just forget about the situation and you do the bold move of saying that you will completely avoid your three-point vertex, and so you make the vertex depend only on one scale, and then it's something quite similar to the propagation and the evaluation of such a diagram is just another form of one loop diagram, and so you can go with your computation. Now it's sure that it's not the end of the world, because you are doing some approximation by shifting this in this way. But the nice thing is that, in fact, you can write the correction to this approximation as some virtual diagram. You just do the difference, and the nice thing is that this difference is more a primitive diagram. It's since in the hot algebra, it's the non-trivial part will be the same for these two diagrams. And so we can go back, we can use all these things to, I will go back to sharing. And you will have it. So, and maybe now I will reach the point that where I go to the maybe the not so hidden motive of this talk. Why can I not go to the next slides? Oh, yes. This is a part of the work of Dirk that I have not used up to now. And maybe you will allow me to ramble a little. Why do I think that it's important? It's an open door to study unitarity questions in quantum field theory. This is at the level of single diagrams, and I would like to do this at the level of Schwinger-Dyson equations. But in some sense, I think that it's long overdue that the quantum field theory go back to Minkowski space and the unitarity and analyticity problems, which have been a little forgotten in past years. It's some old story, and maybe even old when I began knowing theoretical physics. But in the 60s, there was this big excitation around a bootstrap program. This, you know that quantum field theories must have some pretty strong constraint of unitarity, analytic dependence on a bunch of variables, and even this quite mysterious crossing symmetries. And at the time, people said, oh, it could be sufficient to know everything about strong interaction. In some sense, it was not so far-fetched ideas, since the Poisson bound, the bound on unitary on cross sections due to the unitarity constraint is pretty much saturated in hadron interactions. And when you look at amplitude processes with a production of many points, finally the phase space is quite the most important factor, in fact. Nevertheless, it was too short in information, and the idea would disappear all the more so than the first steps into the standard model say that quantum field theory had not said its last word. You can nevertheless remark that one side effect of this project was that Virasoro proposed an amplitude with analyticity and crossing symmetry. And sometime later, people recognized that it was some amplitude for string diffusions, and the rest is history, like one would say. And so, so in some sense, the in a usual swing-like fashion, people had burned what they worshipped, and all the more that the Western approach to the normalization group would give a prominent place to the Euclidean quantum field theories, and with the ability to be subjected to some rigorous approaches of uh, what I was saying. Yes. Of the constructive field theory and a number of other things. But nevertheless, now, I think that it's time to go back to considering this analyticity question. And I would add, it's my the thing I would like to say every time I can is that you have to add another dimension to the analyticity. It's the analyticity in the Borel plane, with which you can have a door to non-perturbative phenomena. This is maybe the subject for further talks. I think that it will be quite time for me to stop. I may just show you a number of things I've done recently. It's what I wanted to show you is it. So what you see there is the quite huge number, which was in the appendix of the paper by Brodus and Kreimer. So it's what you get at order 500 in the when solving the linear Schwinger-Dyson equation for the scalar field in six dimension problem. And so I just tried to you can see the progress in computers. It took only a few seconds to obtain this number. With my MacBook, which is far from being a top of the range machine. And this is just a first step to a full resurgent analysis. But there are some quite difficult points to have. The other thing I would like is it just what can be done in the simpler Yukawa case. Gerald explained you that in this case you can have a quite complete resultant analysis. But this use some quite special properties. So I wanted to see what could be done using more generally available tools. And so the idea is that you can compute terms in the Tron series equation. And if you convert the exponential terms in what Ecal calls transmonomial or resurgent monomial, you can fit the nth order. On the upper scale, it's a perturbative whole, and so I'm fitting the perturbative order. The perturbative series up to some perturbative order with the help of one term, two terms, or three terms. The interesting point are this one. The yellow one corresponds to not well optimized computations. I'm able to compute the coefficient which appear in the bridge equation. So the coefficient which will give you the exact Allen derivatives with better and better precision. In the vertical scale, we have the log of the difference between the number of, and can compute using a number of series coefficients and the limit. So you see that using more and more terms, you can have further and further convergence, and this may be a good thing for quantum fields, general quantum field theory, where even with the tremendous work of such as the one exposed by Oliver Schmitz, it will be difficult to have full computation between beyond the 5, 6, 7 loops on. So thank you for your attention. I just might say that it was a wonderful thing to be able to build upon the nice work of Dirk and his collaborators, and I really hope that it will be possible to have all these ideas that I evocated in the last part of my work be fulfilled with our cooperation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marc.
Truly a good birthday.
All right, thank you, Marc.
Thank you.
Are there questions for Marc?
I have one, if I may. You mentioned this in the Westermeier model where you replace the vertex correction by just a kind of one scale correction by rerouting the external momentum, right?
What I wrote on the board, yes?
Yes, exactly. So I was just wondering, if I remember the paper by Francis and Dirk correctly, the angles and scales, I mean, there's quite some procedure, right, where if you have subdivergences, you have to reroute the momentas and the subdivergences and make everything one scale in a recursive way. So I was just wondering if you do this on the generating function level, like you illustrated, is there a nice way to implement this without having to look into the individual graphs and so on?
In some sense, the point is that whenever you when you look at the this kind of collections, since it behaves at order two primitive graph, it can only contribute to next to leading log correction to the scale behavior. And so you have some systematic way to push to higher on to next to next result exact to up to n to the k log order, and it's quite for me it's quite important because I have some I'm not it's not formally written, but the in some sense in Schwinger-Dyson equation, the leading log behaviors of the propagators on are nearly equivalent to leading behavior of the perturbative series. So,
thank you, Marc.
Are there other questions for Marc? Well, let's thank Marc again.
Thank you.
And I think these...